glaucoma is difficult, and pediatric glaucoma is even more difficult, and we agree with that, that these children are born with a disease, and is this on?
Yeah.
Children are born with this disease, they're going to live longer, and they are going to have problem as time goes by. So I'm just going to take you through what is it that we see in our country, what are the surgical options that we have, what are the outcomes, and what special problems do we face in children. So just take you through a small case. So this is a case of congenital glaucoma. Some of you must have heard this in another of my presentation, possibly in GSI. So this child underwent a trabeculotomy and trabeculectomy. This is typically what we see. Grade 4 to 5 corneal edema is what we see. We really don't see any structures inside the eye. And 1 month post-operative visit, we generally do an examination under anesthesia. This child had white corneas, not much of clearing, had an ulcer in the right eye and left eye, you can see a stromal infiltrate. And it turned out to be a candida, and mother had a birth passage infection and she was treated for the same. So this child, with a lot of difficulty, in fact, even to give antifungals for this child was not difficult. Cornea surgeons are, the pediatric corneal surgery group is a fantastic group. They took care of this child. And ultimately, one eye had a perforation and had to be glued. Finally, the cornea scarred with vascularization. So this is how the child is. And it is not uncommon for us to see somebody like this and say, better left alone, or please send the baby to rehabilitation and teach them the other occasional skills. But I guess we should take a step back and see, is there anything that we can do for these kids? This child underwent bilateral corneal transplantation. The eye that had a perforation actually had the lens was out, so that had to be removed, so it was a phakic. So both eye corneal transplantation was done, and this is how the discs are. So it's not bad at all. This child has a huge potential to see. It's just that it is difficult to treat and we have a long way to go. So the left eye that had the lens that was out, obviously the pressure started going up and required a pars plana vitrectomy with a pars plana tube. This child still comes back for a follow-up. Pressures are well maintained in both the eyes. So what we see in our country is a very, very severe type of primary congenital glaucoma. The prevalence is much more, and we see a severe phenotype. That is because of the high degree of consanguineous marriages that we see in the south part of India. I'm not sure how severe it is in the north, but it is much more common in the south. And a huge variation in presentation. So these managing these glaucomas are difficult, and because of the clinical variability, because there is no standardized criteria, even for diagnosis, even for an IOP, you don't have a specific cutoff. I think there is no set protocol for us to deal with these patients. Uniform definitions have come into place only since a couple of years. And now we know that we can classify them into different categories. This is very, very important because each group of glaucomas behave differently. So we need to understand that all of them are not the same. And when we looked at the profile of childhood glaucomas, this we published recently, it was not surprising, but then we needed to know what are the types of glaucomas that we were dealing with. Close to 56% of them were primary congenital glaucomas or developmental glaucomas. And 44% of them were secondary. This is again very important because all these secondary glaucomas are extremely difficult to treat and they are intractable and they are not easy to manage because of the associated corneal problems that they have or the vitreoretinal problems that they have. So surgery is the initial treatment of choice, and there are various surgical techniques that we perform. It all depends on the corneal clarity of the child's cornea. Goniotomy is not a preferred technique because we hardly see any child with clear cornea, maybe extremely rare. One eye of the child may be partially clear, and that we can try and do only a goniotomy or a trabeculotomy, but most often we deal with a combined trabeculotomy and trabeculectomy, and that is our preferred technique. It does quite well in the beginning, and as time goes by, like all other glaucoma surgeries, they do fail, and this is what we have seen even in our own populations. And when we deal with the severe presentation, to begin with, many of these children actually require a second surgery. We looked at our own data as to how many of these patients actually require a second surgery. Close to 1/4 of them require a second procedure. What are the second procedures that we can do in them? Starting from medical treatment to needling of the primary surgery to goniotomy. I do goniotomy more often as a second procedure in these children when the cornea has actually cleared. Repeat trabeculectomy, drainage devices, and cyclodestructive procedures. Where a conventional procedure may not help, we need to think of all the other techniques. So anything that can give you even a 6 months time to me is a good technique where I can delay doing a second procedure. I don't mind doing that, whether it is needling or a goniotomy or whatever it is. Be very, very careful in using mitomycin in kids because we have to worry about their conjunctiva and the thin blebs for the rest of their life. Implants, of course, are definitely useful options, especially in these refractory glaucomas. Extremely rare for me to do implant as a primary procedure in a child, unless it is a difficult kind of a secondary glaucoma or multiple previous intraocular surgeries have the child has undergone, then I don't mind doing it, but otherwise it's not a primary choice. A few things that I do differently that maybe I can just show you. In fact, all the implants for me, it's a limbal based conjunctival opening. So I think because we deal with a lot of kids, and all children, usually it is limbal based, where there's a single continuous suture that we place right in the, almost close to the fornix. So I guess that's the same thing that we follow. And for me, it is the same, whether it is a AGV or an Adi. Even for an Adi, the incision size need not be beyond 6 millimeters. So just about 6 to 7 millimeters from the limbus, just between the two recti muscle is the incision that we give. And however large the implant is, it doesn't really matter. We can place it through the same conjunctival incision because closure becomes extremely easy. And your the tube where it is filtering, the patch graft that is there, plus your suture, they are not in the same line. So to a great extent, it helps us to, at least for me, it helps prevent a lot of complications, especially related to conjunctiva. Plus, the surgery is much quicker. And a smaller adequate length of the tube and parallel insertion of the tube, especially in children. We need to leave a longer tube because the eye grows and the tube retracts, which is very, very common because of these growing eyes. However, leaving a longer tube can lead to problems of tube corneal touch. So leaving a tube that is parallel to the limbus, even if it is longer, even if there is a tube corneal touch, it is right in the periphery and it is not going to compromise the visual axis. Choosing a location is extremely important. These eyes, because you know, in child's eye, as the glaucoma increases, the eyeball enlarges and the anatomy is completely distorted. So you may have to resort to even choosing the location based on where actually you can even identify where the pars plana is. And even if you have to do a pars plana tube, in fact, this was a case where the vitreoretinal surgeon had to struggle for close to 20 minutes to understand where the location of the pars plana was. If you go slightly posterior is retina. If you go anterior, you may be actually hitting the ciliary body. And you may end up having problems. So we need to be careful. Some of these eyes may require multimodal treatment for both glaucoma and corneal procedures. Some of them, we in fact don't, I personally don't do the corneal procedures and the tube simultaneously for two reasons. One is that one is to understand the visual potential. Number two, for a graft, especially in these complex eyes, you don't need, you should not have a hypotony. So however well done, especially because of these children, the globe collapses, even with a valved implant, hypotony is not uncommon. If that is the case, then you need to be very, very careful. So doing a graft and you don't want a hypotony, doing a glaucoma surgery, that is what you're inducing. So I would actually defer it as a second step and do it as a second procedure. Do one first followed by the other, whichever way, based on whether the corneal clarity is a problem or the intraocular pressure is a problem. We looked at our own results. We compared the outcomes of primary versus secondary glaucomas with the AGV, and they do fare well in the beginning. And this was the 1 year data, and this at second year it dropped to about close to 70%. So we know that as time goes by, these are going to fail. And we also published our results on comparison of AGV versus Adi in pediatric glaucoma. Of course, Adi does well in terms of intraocular pressure control. Definitely much better than AGV, especially when the complete success is concerned. However, problems and complications in kids are far, far worse. So we need to be very, very careful because these eyes behave completely differently to hypotony. Apart from the complications that you commonly see in adults, in children, the serious problem that we have is a long-term hypotony. So it's not when the ligature opens up, that time you are actually stepping up the steroids and doing all sorts of things that we need to take care of. But long term, that means about 3 months from the time of surgery or 4 months from the time of surgery, they can come back with a hypotony. It's possibly because of the thin bleb wall that is formed, they need some resistance. So we need to be careful. Not always, but yes, in some situations. And if you see an indication like that, one of the things that has helped for me, either use a permanent ligature or I use a 30 nylon to just go and stent the tube for a short time. That means what happens is a non-absorbable suture, if you go and ligate, a large piece of that suture material is sitting in the conjunctiva. So I'm also worried about erosions through them. So I haven't done an anterior approach, but that is something that we can try. Like in adults, it's very difficult for you to see the faces of, post-operatively, faces of what the eye is going through. This is in an adult where you can see the ridge, you can see the ligature there, you can see the patch graft, things are fine. And when you know when it opens up, you have a diffuse bleb, things are okay. But in a child, they don't allow you to do so. So you have to restrain. The more you restrain, the more you try to pull the lids away, the more they're going to squeeze. It only will cause more problem. So what has helped me is ultrasound B scan. So this is something, one piece of equipment, if you ask me, if you would like to buy and keep it in your own clinic, I would actually want a B scan. That is because in these kids, every visit when they come, weekly, monthly, whenever it is, just all you have to do is do a B scan to see posterior segment. Cornea, anyway, you'll be able to visualize posterior segment, whether it is fine or not. You can understand both the problem related posteriorly, that means whether there is hypotony, thickened choroid, choroidal detachment, and also the, so this is different faces of the same eye of this child who had an implant done, non-valved implant done, no fluid around the plate, you can see that, no fluid around the plate, minimal fluid around the plate, a lot of fluid around the plate, there was some amount of, you can see the vitreous condensation and thickening of the choroid. This is when the child developed an extensive choroidal detachment in the late postoperative period. At every visit, you will be able to image and try to see them, and that helps significantly in managing these patients. Other things that we need to be taking care of is, I always use a 24 gauge needle entry, which is what comes with a 2 cc syringe. So although 23 is fine, but I prefer to use a 24 gauge, and whether it is an adult or a child, to me that is perfectly all right. And if you are doing a pars plana tube, for me, I always request my vitreoretinal surgeon if it is possible to do a 25 gauge vitrectomy, because sclera is very, very elastic, and we, through that we can still pass the tube. And I think the peritubular leakage, one more problem that you can have, you can try and avoid. And of course, we can't emphasize more on the conjunctival closure and eye rubbing. So in fact, we have made, in the US, you have these elbow restrainers. In India, we don't have it. When I visited there and bought a couple of them from here and asked a lot of people to do it, they couldn't. In our own institute, we have our engineering department, which has helped us. And now we have it available. So basically, I give it for free. I said, please take this, make sure that the child doesn't rub the eye. So doing surgery is one part, but I guess post-operative management is so important that it is maybe 60% of your management, much more than what you actually can do during surgery. Cyclodestructive procedures, I generally try and keep it to the last, only in those eyes where they are non-seeing. They are very, very difficult to titrate. Like I said, anatomy itself is a problem. So several times you will have to do the diode CPC almost about 3 millimeters or 4 millimeters from the limbus. Because of the stretch, you don't know. So you try and keep the probe and then try to first assess where is it that you hear a pop at a higher energy. And once I know that this is the location, then I try to reduce it, and that is where I do it. So like conventionally what you do for an adult at the limbus, and you know where exactly you're delivering the laser, in a child that is not possible. So everything is difficult in them, and we need to be careful. And phthisis is again a major problem. Plus, on the other hand, it works only temporarily and the pressures can shoot up again. So this is usually at the last option, or if I have to, if a tendency for a scarring is so high, and if the first implant has failed after all that we have done before moving to a second implant, I would try to use this as a temporizing measure. And some children it has helped, but otherwise this is not my primary choice. So first thing that we will try to ask, apart from recording the intraocular pressure in a child, we have to consider all the other factors, including the cornea, corneal diameter, increase in axial length, myopic shift in refraction, as well as the changes in the disc. Most often in these complex cases, we may not even be able to see the disc. And if there's a possibility to try and evaluate it at every visit that they come is extremely important. And as they grow older, visual fields or imaging, although we know you can't compare it with the normative database, but you still can have a baseline of their own readings. So to summarize, refractory childhood glaucomas are definitely a challenge. We need to choose the type of surgery that we need to employ at that particular stage for the child, and maybe modify it compared to what we normally do in an adult. And tubes definitely have an important role to play in helping these children. And huge number of complications, some of them are very specific for children, but most often all the tube related complications, either they are related to hypotony or they are related to the tube erosion and implant exposure. For me, with the modified technique that I do, in the past 15 years, I have seen 2 conjunctival erosions, of which one is a child. So it's not common to have it, but I think what is important is to use a long tunnel. I can't agree more with George, 4 millimeter tunnel. And over on top of that, I'm really obsessed with it. Over on top of that, I also put a patch graft, which is quite large, covering the entire length of the tube, almost until the implant. And then I glue it, and I also suture it. Because that even that little bit of 1 millimeter retraction that happens, the tube erosions can happen usually, which is more common close to the limbus, between 1 and 2 millimeters to the limbus. That is something that we can avoid. So, and the conjunctival opening as well as the closure which happens right posteriorly, I believe all of these factors will help significantly in preventing these complications in children. And once this settles down, then rarely do you see it. One complication that I find in children, which is not so common in adults, is absorption, resorption of the patch graft, which happens in a, almost like a tongue-like fashion. Again, that happens close to the limbus. So that is where the long track also helps, plus use a patch graft. Whatever patch graft is of choice to you can help to prevent several of these complications. And of course, lifelong follow-up is very important. Thank you for your attention.